Did you enjoy it so far? You having a good time so far?
Hey.
Well, we have a little surprise for you folks. Jeff Slutsky, who put this whole thing together, did a lot of research on you people, and we decided to honor you with just showing you and thanking you for all the things that you've done for other people and showing you just a few of your favorite things.
No more injections for type 2 diabetes. Aid circulation in your hands and your feeties. Give up the needles, it's not a mirage. When I prescribe just for you glucophage. There is no cure, but we're big on prevention. Let's get aggressive with your hypertension. When I prescribe this for you, take this pill. One time each day, won't you take but a pill? When you're smoking, not too active, and your weight's too high, you come in to see me for some travel call. And we'll stop at first MI.
Oh, my. Now we get to eavesdrop on a couple of doctors who are consulting about any number of ailments, and especially in the first part of the song, the second doctor seems to have all of the answers. Here is a chart of a man with a goiter. Picking at his rear cause of him a Reuters. He's been eating too much at the Golden Arches. Showing no signs of myocardial infarction. Early risk recognition, so take Pravacol, no lie. Early risk intervention helps prevent a first MI. Pravacol helps your blood get purer. Hopefully avoid cardiac rotarooter. You have all the answers, no doubt.
What have you got to help with diarrhea? What have you got for painful stomach gas?
What do you got to help them go pee-pee-a? Or bad discharge or kidney stones to pass? What do you got for headache and for cramping? What do you got for pressure that is low?
And in case of incontinence or in case of impotence, how do you help them coming or to go?
Oh, what do you got to help with diarrhea? How do you do it in an HMO?
Blue Cross Blue Shield, you can't cover payroll. So be sure to withhold, keep liabilities low.
Claim every patient, charge for the test. Depreciate.
Oh, but there's more.
Standing on the left fence, I like that. Anyway, this next little ditty, this little thing, is actually a consultation between a patient and the doctor.
You use too much salt, and you eat like a pig. You're a heart attack just waiting. You sit on the couch, and you don't exercise. And you're way too tired for mating. You're 216 over 117. Your heart's about to blow. Treat your TikToker, receptor blocker. Daily take Avapro. Lower systolic and diastolic, tested with placebos. I learned in a luncheon, no sex dysfunction. Daily take Avapro. Be sure to take this pill each day and walk or exercise. Insurance claims may be copay. See if your coverage buys. You need to take better care of you. No one wants to see you go. I hate to mention your hypertension. Daily take Avapro.
I'm 216 over 117. That's what your gauges show. Yes, it's a shocker, but you're my doctor. Daily it's Avapro. You took a measure of my blood pressure. Now change my status quo. And I'm not joking, I'll quit my smoking. Daily it's Avapro. And I will take this pill each day. I know it's well advised. And I'll do most everything you say. I'll even exercise. I will take much better care of me. No need to leave me go. No need to mention my hypertension.
Daily it's Avapro.
And now, finally, the theme song to this musical, which, along with your drugs and your great services, made this night possible and really was the inspiration to Jeff as he wrote all of these wonderful songs. Steve.
The halls are alive with the sounds of mucus. A cough and a sneeze in the waiting room. And the patients arrive for their shots in the torcas. A future mom waits to hear her
There's a kid with sore ears and a runny nose and a man in a wheelchair. He's here for the pain in his broken toe. All he has is Medicare. There are x-rays to read and charts to review, and the waiting room is full. There's a pap smear to prep, and in walk a
endurance. The payments are late from the Medicaid. We're getting more grief from cats in insurance, and they are late.
Thank you very much. You've been beautiful. Thank you. LaDonna Gatlin.
Steve Rizzo.
Thank you so much.
And the song stylings of Jeff Slutsky. Well, thank you. That was great fun. That was great fun. And if we may just end with this one song, I would like to say personally, I owe everyone in here a tremendous debt of gratitude. As I was hearing the second speaker speak about the angioplasty, my father-in-law is a survivor of that, and I'm very grateful for that medical technology and procedure that is available. He is almost 77 years old and doing quite well. My husband is a 16-year survivor of cancer, and maybe that may not be your specialty, but I'm sure glad that people like you and drug companies like you are in place to help, because it takes all of us working together in harmony to make a better life for everyone. You heard the Gatlin brothers sing a little while ago, and you heard that great harmony that they sang, and that didn't just, well, not those Gatlin brothers, the real ones on the tape. You heard that great harmony, and that didn't just happen overnight. You see, it took a lot of days of my mom sitting down at the piano and plunking out the notes and teaching each one of us our part, and we had to practice it over and over and over until we got it just right. But when we got it just right, it made for great harmony, Grammy Award-winning harmony. And I believe that same kind of harmony is right here in this room tonight. It's doctors and drug companies and people working together and not being afraid to do it over and over and over again until they get it just right. And you don't sing your song maybe like I do, or with a microphone in your hand like Steve does telling jokes, but you sing your song every day, whether you realize it or not, through your words and your deeds and your actions, how you live your life and what you're contributing to all of those around us to help make us a healthier group of people. And I just want to leave you with this song, which we wrote especially for folks like you. And it simply says this: when the song in you sings out a melody, that melody makes harmony a reality. When you listen with your heart, you can play the missing part, and the song in you can make hopes and dreams come true. Silence is a lonely cry in a world of need. We're afraid to even speak a caring word. But there is a song in you that only you can sing. It's the one thing that only you can give. That means everything to someone who is crying out to live. When the song in you sings out a melody, then that melody makes harmony a reality. When you with your heart, you can play the missing part, and that song in you can make hopes and dreams come true. Laughter is a lonely cry in a world of pain. They're afraid, so they hide their hurts inside. Theirs is an empty song, full of heartache and suffering. They would give anything just to hear your caring words. We'll to someone with a song they've never heard, and the song in you sings out a melody, and that melody makes harmony a reality. When you listen with your heart, you can the missing part, and that song in you can make hopes and dreams come true. Yes, the song in you will make hopes and dreams come true. For letting us sing our song. You guys, keep singing yours.
Sting, LaDonna Gatlin.
Sting Rizzo.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If you're happy and you know it, clap your hands. Just checking. The five people happy, no one else is. That's great. My name is Steve Rizzo. I am from Brooklyn, New York, which means I speak two languages, English and Brooklynonics, because that's true, because Brooklyn people have their own vocabulary. They have their own way of saying things and their own way of doing things. You ever see a Brooklyn cop? Freeze! Hey, you know, Tony, not for nothing, but I think we did something backwards. Hey, there you go particulating the whole situation again. Why can't you look at the bright side? The point is, he ain't moving, right? Thusly, he froze. Chill out and have a donut. Everywhere I go, and I travel a lot, folks. I mean, I travel a lot. Everywhere I go, people are always telling me that there is a similarity between the Boston accent and the Brooklyn accent. And I can't see the similarity at all. Because I have friends from Boston, and when I'm with them, I have no idea what they're talking about. I was with them a couple of months ago. They said, Steve, come on, we're going to go to a bar. I said, what? They said, come on, we're going to go to a bar. I said, it sounds like a place where there's a lot of sheep. I'm not interested. Thank you. Come on, let's go potty. I don't have to go potty, and if I did, I'll go by myself there, jeez. Well, they talk like that, folks, they do. They say car, they park the car, water. The Kennedys are from that area, you know. Ted Kennedy parked the car in the water. Oh, you're finally getting into this stuff now all of a sudden, okay. Because he went to a bar and had too much of a patty. See, the thing is, you know when you're talking to somebody from Brooklyn, because when they talk to you, they're always repeating your name. Hey, Tony, how you doing, Tony? Hey, Bobby, how are you, Bobby? Unless they're not too bright, then it's like, hey, Joey, how are you, Louie? Hey, Freddie, how you doing, Frankie? Okay, nice to talk to you. Everybody says people from Brooklyn have an attitude. Personally, I think you need an attitude to live today, personally. Not that you need to be sarcastic or rude, but you need an edge. It makes you live longer. That's why I think every cat in the world has a Brooklyn attitude. Because if you have a cat, you know what I'm talking about. How many people have cats? Am I right? Cats walk around like they're God's gift to the animal kingdom. If cats could talk, they'd go meow, meow, bada bing, meow. Yeah, I'm walking here. Most incredible animals. See, dogs are the dumbest animals in the world, I think. I have two dogs and two cats. Dogs always have that guilty look on their face. Even if they didn't do it. You know, you come home and you go, who made this mess? Oh God, it must have been me. I'm sorry, I was walking. It came out, apparently I'm not well. Don't hit me with the paper. Look, I'm sick. My tail's between my legs. I'm going to throw up. Leave me alone. I'll prove to you that your cat has a Brooklyn attitude. When you go home tonight, you look at your cat and you tell your cat to get the stick. Good. Just tell your cat, get the stick. They look at you like, what? Hey, kiss my furry butt. I don't get dings. You want something? You tell your best friend Rover to get it. I'm busy. I got company coming over. And when they get here, don't embarrass me with this here kitty kitty stuff. I got a name. You use it. Even if it is fluffy, you use it. Because a dog will do anything, you know. You tell any dog in the world, tell the meanest dog in the world, get the stick. Okay, I'll be right back. It landed in that truck, but I'll get it. My mom and dad taught me three things in life. Doesn't really matter who you're from, doesn't matter what kind of an attitude you have, doesn't matter who you are, you need a sense of humor about everything in your life. And I think that's absolutely true. Because my dad is Italian. My dad's a very proud Italian. My father thinks what this country needs is an Italian for president. Think about it, look at her, yes! Are you Italian? That's why you said yes. And you are you all Italian or just part? Just part, what's the other part?
Slovak.
Slovak, really? Whew. That's a good one. I'm Irish and Italian, so I get drunk and kill people, so. If you wanna go out and party later, just let me know. My dad is a very proud Italian. My father thinks what this country needs is an Italian for president. Think about it, folks. If we had an Italian for president, we wouldn't know if he was lying or not, because Italian people just don't like to answer questions. I mean, the press would have a heck of a time with him. Mr. President, what are your plans for the future? Hey, I'm going to do things. That's all you need to know. All right, who is this guy? Get his number. Folks, I'll tell you what. If we had an Italian for president, we would not be having a problem with Saddam Hussein right now. I'll tell you that right now. Because an Italian president would have put Saddam Hussein in his place a long time ago. Use your imagination. Picture this. Italian president, all right? He's sitting in the Oval Office. He's with the boys. He's talking business. In the background, the national anthem's playing. Hey, let's get Ambassadors Tony and Louie. Go over there and talk to that moron, Saddam. The Ambassadors Tony and Louie are formerly from the Roy George Vending Company of New Jersey. They wind up in Saddam's tent with three-piece suits, pinky rings. Hey, Saddam, how you doing, eh? You know, we was talking. This is a nice country you got here. It would be a shame if something should happen to it. Capisce? No, like an accident. You know, God forbid. One day your country's here, and the next day it ain't. Yeah, Saddam wakes up the next morning. There's a camel's head in his bed.
They killed Spotty.
See, now, if you saw The Godfather, you would know that's a very funny line. If you didn't, you have no idea what I'm talking about. Also, if we had an Italian for president, I guess we'll bring a whole new meaning to the term veto power, too, wouldn't it? Veto power to an Italian president is when Congress passes a bill that the president doesn't like, and the president goes, hey, veto.
You want it should hurt somebody, boss?
Doesn't it feel good to laugh when you release that tension? Why don't we do it more often? That's what I want to know. Laughter has been proven scientifically to reduce stress in our lives. We all go through stress. We all do. Let me ask you this. How many of you get upset when you're in a traffic jam? How many? See, most of us. The rest of us don't drive, I guess, then, right? Are you aware that the mood that you're in as a result of that traffic jam will probably determine the mood you're going to be in for the whole day? That doesn't sound very promising, does it? Think about it. Especially if you have a business meeting to go to. Maybe it's your anniversary. Maybe it's your kid's birthday. That mood can pretty much ruin the whole day. So let me ask you this. Why don't you laugh when you're in a traffic jam? I got you there, don't I? Because look, right now half of you are giving me the Archie Bunker look. Well, that's because it's not funny there, meathead, huh? Oh, geez, help me, Lord, get him out of there. Well, make it funny. Do what I do. When I'm in a traffic jam, I know I have a choice. You always have a choice. I can either get into a bad mood or a good mood. Now, folks, I figure if I have a choice, I'm going to do anything I possibly can do to keep me from getting in that bad mood. And what I usually do is something crazy, and I do this. Usually, I turn into the lion from The Wizard of Oz. I figure it's going to be hours before I get home, so what the heck? Everyone else is angry, their blood pressure's going high, they're beeping the horns, they're cursing at each other, not me. If you look at me, I'm looking right back at you going, I want to go home. I want to go home. Yeah, you laugh. People in the next car are going, don't look at him and he won't say anything. Oh, my God, he's a pervert, honey. He's got a New York license plate. Lock the door. Look straight ahead. Don't look at him. He's probably naked from the waist down. Don't look at him. See, you might think I'm crazy. So might everybody else that's in traffic. But you know what, folks? At least I know I'm not going home to my family, to my job, or a business meeting in a bad mood. I'm not meeting with a patient in a bad mood. As a matter of fact, I'm going there in a good mood. Why? Because I was able to change my state of mind. I was able to go from a potentially bad mood to a good mood just by using my sense of humor as a tool. The good news is that we all have the power to do this. You just have to understand one thing. Some people just don't have a sense of humor. Okay? State troopers do not have a sense of humor. And here's a list of things you never, ever say to a state trooper. Can I see a license and registration, please? Sure, you want to hold my beer? Didn't you see that stop sign? Yep, saw it. Just didn't see you hiding behind it. Hey, are you drinking? Well, I don't know. Are you buying? Well, wise guy, it looks like I'm going to have to give you a ticket for speeding. Well, could you make it quick? It's pretty apparent I'm in a hurry. You know what it is? It's like after laughs in this room, so I got to wait for you folks to stop. Because there's like a delay. Some of you get it right away, and the rest of you, do you look at somebody else? Oh, that was funny? Okay, yeah. I got it now. The last thing you never ever say to a state trooper, how come you didn't stop when I was chasing you? Well, a couple of years ago, my wife ran away with a state trooper, and I thought you were trying to return her. See, the men love this. The men go, ha ha, and the women go, hey, 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 hey! But you need that sense of humor today. My whole philosophy on life is about that. It really is. Because, you know, life is always throwing that stuff at you every day. And you can't stop that. Life is always going to throw stuff at you. Life is supposed to be difficult. It's what you deal with the difficulties, I believe, is what really makes a difference. Even when you're sleeping. Even when you're sleeping, you think you finally have that time that you deserve of rest. You ever get that wake-up call? 3 o'clock in the morning, it's the wrong number. Hi, is Bill there? Oh, no, sorry, you got the wrong number. Oh, did I wake you up? No, I'm a vampire, okay, pal? And you hang up the phone, you're upset because you don't think you have a choice on how to deal with it. But you do. Folks, next time you get a wrong number like that and they go, hi, is Bill there? Go, Bill's dead, man, and hang up. You might not go back to sleep, but you're going to be laughing your butt off, I'll tell you that right now. And I have found it's a lot easier to go back to sleep in a good mood than it is when you're in a bad mood. The point is that you have a choice. It's just not easy for us to deal with our challenges from a humorous perspective because it's not the way we were brought up. As my father used to tell me all the time, my father used to say, you may not be able to control what happens to you in your life, but you can always control how you think about what happens. My dad's a psychologist, by the way. Not licensed. You know, self-appointed. He always walked around giving us those motivational seminars, you know. You also thought he was king of the house, too. You ever hear this from your father when you were living home? You're living in my house. You do what I tell you to do, and you're living in my house. You're living under my roof. I pay the bills. This is my house. You're sitting in my chair. You, get your butt out there and mow the lawn. Why, it ain't my lawn. And now you're a part of the lawn. You, idiot, pick up your brother and mow the lawn. Not with your brother. Put him down, then mow it. And I couldn't keep my mouth closed. I always had to have the last word. And I know you're thinking, shocker. My brothers would tell me all the time, shut up, man, don't say anything. I couldn't help it. If there was a punchline there, I had to say it. Biggest beating I ever got is when my father said, what kind of idiot do you think I am? Well, Pop, what are the categories? My brothers would be like, I told you, you shouldn't have said anything.
Yeah, but it was worth it.
Didn't you ever do that with your folks? I mean, I had to. See, a lot of us keep their mouths closed. I couldn't help it. I used to love when my mom was in one end of the house and I'd be in the other end. And I used to love when my mother would go, hey, don't make me repeat myself. And I'd be like, what? You heard me. I said, don't make me repeat myself. What? This would go on for hours. And I'm like, geez, no wonder she doesn't have a day job here, huh? Big difference between mom and dad's growing up, though, I think. I found growing up that my mom cared about me, my welfare. My dad cared about his stuff, his things. That's all he cared about. If I were to say to my father, Dad, I'm going to use your tools, first thing he'd say is, don't break my tools. You can use them, but don't break my tools and don't lose them. First thing my mother would say is, be careful. Oh, my God, don't get hurt. Just be careful. See the difference? She cares about me. He cares about his stuff. Okay, you can see. It's true. Even when I got older, I would say, Dad, I'm going to use the car. Well, just don't wreck it. Don't wreck the car, for crying out loud. First thing my mother would say is, be careful. Oh, my God, just be careful. Be safe. Don't get hurt. See that difference? Guess what happened? First time you let me use the car. I was so afraid about not getting into an accident, I had to. It wasn't bad. It was a little fender bender. But at 17 years old, that was the end of the world to me. I remember getting out of my car, going into a phone booth, going, oh, my God, please answer the phone. Please, Mom, answer the phone. My mom answers. I go, Mom, it's me. I got into an accident. First thing she says is, oh, my God, are you okay? I hear my father in the background. What happened? It's Steven. He got into an accident. How's the car? My mom's like, it's your son. He got into an accident. My father's like, hey, we have 3 sons, 1 car. That's my father's attitude. We had an incredible, incredible sense of humor, my family did. Life threw stuff at us that you just wouldn't believe. I can do a half-day seminar, a full-day seminar on my family and all the stuff that life threw at us. And at the end of it, you would say, no, you're making some of that up. And I wouldn't be. But we always managed to laugh it off somehow, some way. It was that sense of humor that always kept us together. We needed that stuff. You know, when I was growing up, I remember I was a very sensitive kid. I took things literally. And there were certain things that I didn't understand. So, you know, to counteract it, I made jokes out of it. You know, like when I got older, a little older, I was about 9 years old, my mom went through her changes and I didn't know what that was. All I know is that I love my mom, and every now and then she'd flip out. It's all she would do is sweat and talk like a parrot. I'm hot, I'm hot, I'm hot, I'm hot, I'm hot, I can't go, look at me, I'm hot, I'm hot, I can't go out. I'm like, Mom, it's 28 degrees below zero, you're outside in your underwear, get in here. No, go ahead, what happened? I'm hot, I can't go out, look at me, I'm sweating, I'm hot, are you hot, I'm hot. So you're laughing, 5 years out of my life, that my friends would be knocking on the door. You have a parrot in your house, it's my mother, she's hot, get the hell away from me, okay? We couldn't even take a food shopping, there'd be an announcement. There's a lady in aisle 7 sweating to death. Someone with a mop to aisle 7? My father's in the next aisle. The hell with the mop, get her a cracker. She's hot. Ah, she's hot. Ah. And my father's Italian. You know, he didn't have patience for stuff like that. My father would be like, hey, hey, you going through your changes? Okay, fine. You got 10 minutes, start changing. And like I said, I was a very sensitive kid. All I would know is that one moment my mom was great, the next moment she flipped out. I remember, I would take things literally. I really would. I remember walking into the kitchen. Hi, Mom, what's for dinner? The dog, okay? The little mangy dog. I'm not hungry anyway, Mom. Could you tell me where my dog is? I don't see you walking around. That night we're eating dinner, my father's going, boy, I can eat a horse. You're close, Dad. You have no idea how close you are. You don't see Bingo walking around anywhere, do you? Mom has a great sense. I should tell you this little story, being that there are doctors here, because you probably appreciate this. Two years ago, my mom had to go for major surgery. Just to give you an idea on what a sense of humor she has. We had to have major surgery done. I won't explain that, but she had major surgery done. And a week before the surgery, my mom and dad had to meet with the doctor to go over the surgery procedure. So when this doctor walks into the office, he was stunned because he only had anticipated my mom and dad in the office. He didn't expect the whole Rizzo family. It was myself, my wife, my brother, his wife, my other brother, his wife, my sister, her husband, my cousin, and his wife. So this guy walks in, and if you look at my family, the Brady Bunch were not, okay? I just want to give you, I mean, I have a brother, Rocky, okay? Rocky Rizzo, you figure it out.
Yo, Doc, what's wrong with my mother, right?
So, I know, it was a good impression. But anyway, the doctor, you know, this added more tension to an already stressful situation, because we're all concerned about my mom. And my mom notices the tension in the room, so we all introduce ourselves, and the doctor goes, well, let's continue this. So the doctor goes, I'm going to ask you a few questions, maybe some symptoms that you may be having. So the doctor goes to my mom, he goes, do you have a problem with hearing at all? My mom goes, what? See, the doctor doesn't get it, you know, so we're starting to laugh. So then he repeats the question again. He goes, do you have a problem with hearing at all? My mom goes, no, and what are you yelling at me for? So all of a sudden, we all start laughing. The doctor goes, oh, I get it, you're a comedian. My mom goes, no, he's the comedian, I'm the patient. If you can't tell the distance, I'm out of here. So I'm thinking to myself, oh, God, she's on a roll. Here we go. So then the doctor goes, you have a problem with your memory loss at all? So my mom goes, no, I'm fine with that. She leans over and she goes, but I do have a question. Who are these people in the room with us? See what the sense of humor did? It broke the tension to the point where we all felt relaxed. We asked the right questions. When we walked out of there, we felt very secure that he was the right person for the job and that the surgery needed to be performed. We even had our sense of humor with us when the day of the operation, my father and my brothers and I, my mom was in this room with eight other patients all getting ready to be operated on, and we were making fun of hospital procedure. No offense, but there are some things you can make fun of. And I must admit that I took the cake when I grabbed rubber surgical gloves. This is all true stuff, and I blew them up. We had all the patients in this room hysterical in tears. But when I grabbed these rubber surgical gloves and I blew them up, you know, the fingers protrude, you know, they stick out. So I get on all fours, and I'm like, I don't know why it struck this one lady, but she was laughing so hard and screaming for a bedpan at the same time. And I'm proud to say that the bedpan didn't get there fast enough. I really am. That's when a nurse literally grabbed me by the collar like a 14-year-old and said, look, you either stay here or we put you in a psychiatric ward, okay? I'm looking at her like Jack Nicholson. Please don't take me to the cuckoo's nest, lady. And I'll never forget, my mom was heavily sedated and they were wheeling her away. And it was a very touching moment. And, you know, her eyes are opening and closing and she's going in and out of consciousness, I guess. And I remember leaning over her and I remember saying, Mom, I love you, Mom. And she looked up at me and she said, forget it, son, you're not getting my Bud Light. It's a sick family. Like I said, we always manage to use our sense of humor, but you know, a lot of us just don't know how to utilize our sense of humor as a tool. I suggest every morning, as soon as you wake up, find something to laugh at before you start your day. The power that you get from that's incredible. Look at most people going, well, I can't find something to laugh at. Look at yourself as soon as you wake up in the morning. That's real funny. Just look at yourself. Don't even get dressed. Look into a full-length mirror and go, well, I'm ready to go to work. That doesn't make you laugh. Nothing will. I don't know about you, but I look like that character Jim from Taxi when I wake up in the morning.
Hey, is that my face or did my neck throw up?
You want something real funny to laugh at, folks? Look at your kids. Little kids are the funniest people in the world. Watch them. Put your laughter caps on. Little kids are like old people. You tell them what to do, they walk away and they mumble. They do. You hear them going to the room going, I didn't do nothing. What are you expecting of me for? I got to get in trouble. Everybody else is in trouble with you. We get a good big. What are you saying? Nothing. God can't even breathe. Am I right with that look? Like you're, I hate that look. You know, that look like you're a blithering idiot in their eyes. I didn't do nothing. You didn't do anything. Oh, then what are you yelling at me for? And I'm a nonviolent person, but it is that kind of a look where you just want to go, and they have all the answers today. Oh, go ahead, hit me. Go ahead, I'll call the child abuse hotline. Oh, I got the number off the television. Oh, yeah? Well, how are you going to dial it if you can't freaking move? That's what I want to know. God, Dad, can't even take a joke. Chill out. Hey, hey, I'll chill out. And who do you think you're talking to? Your friends in the street?
No. Sorry, Dad, I'm not talking to my friends in the street because my friends aren't going bald.
That's it, now you're punished. Okay, I'm sorry, you're not going bald. Your head's getting too big for your hair. So I punish him. This is my son I'm talking about when he was a little kid. I punish him, but he has no idea why he's being punished, which makes me look like an idiot, see? Because his friends are going up to him going, how come you're punished? Because my father's going bald. You figure it out, fellas. I didn't do nothing. Your father's punishing you because he's losing his hair? Yeah. I don't know what's going to happen to me when it's all gone. Watch your kids. Put your laughter caps on, man. Watch them. Watch how your kids grow up to be just like you. My son thinks he's a comedian. That's not funny. It used to be, but when he was younger, he would get in trouble. He would make people laugh, and he didn't know when to stop. He would come home from school, and I'd be like, hey, how was school? And he'd say, good crowd, good crowd. I'm like, don't get smart with me. Don't worry, I don't want to confuse you. Even does impressions. First day of school, the teacher said, so young man, what's your name? And he went, well, what's it to you, lady? Yeah, teacher gives me a call. Mr. Rizzo, we have a problem. Your son thinks he's Jack Nicholson. And I'm like, what the hell you want me to do? Yeah, well, just don't get on his nerves. You're laughing. If you ever wanted to know what Nicholson sounded like as a little kid, if you would have talked to my son when he was younger, it was really uncanny. It was very weird. He sounded just like him. And this is a true story. This happened years ago. I was asked to do some voiceover work for a Jack Nicholson movie that was aired on TV. Okay, now voiceover work means you take the movie version, okay, and you cut the curse words out and you fill it in with regular words so we could watch it on network TV. You've seen it. It looks really stupid, okay? But that was my job and it was my big break. And, you know, that whole week, I'm walking around the house and I'm practicing my Jack. I'm walking the dog like Jack and I'm doing the dishes and I'm mowing the lawn. My son's following me around. I'm big Jack and he's little Jack. I thought it was really cute the whole week we're doing this until the end of the week when I took him out for his birthday, okay? And the waitress comes by and gives him an ice cream and gives him a spoon that was huge. It was a really big spoon. My son is checking this spoon out. I know he's going to say something. I just don't know what it's going to be. So the waitress is walking away and my son's like, yo, lady, why don't you just give me a damn shovel? This is the big one, Elizabeth. I was so embarrassed. Did you ever reprimand a kid, and as you're reprimanding him, you're telling him it's not funny as you're laughing at the same time? You know what I mean? Because you know what he did was wrong, but yet you thought it was funny, too. So you're like, come on, I'm serious, not... And the kid's confused. He's like... That's got to be one of the toughest things about bringing up kids today, I think. When they do something wrong, you know it's wrong, but at the same time, it's very funny. And you have to reprimand them, but how do you do that? And sometimes it's very intelligent, too. How do you deal with that? I'll never forget the time I said to my son, I said, hey, you can't go out, period. He said, but why? Question mark. I said, because I'm bigger, exclamation point. He's like, but Dad, comma. Watch your kids. Kids are just an example of the humor that's in your life. We get upset over the craziest things, man. Put those laughter caps on. Then when you leave the house, you're in that good mood. When you're in that traffic jam, why get upset? Look at everybody in traffic from a different perspective. Look at it as if it were a circus, because sometimes it is. Sitting in traffic, you watch the craziest people. You got people that are trying to eat their food while they're driving, the people that are singing your songs on the radio, right? They're really belting it out and they're really into the song until you look at them and they go, not me. You look at me singing behind a wheel of a car, just look right at you and go, I don't care. So the one time I was embarrassed singing behind the wheel of my car was when I lived in LA and I had a red convertible and I was at a red light and it was 98 degrees. And it was call out of people on one side, call out of people on the other. And I was, you know how you get into a song, you don't realize you're singing it, but you're singing it. And I was singing the words to Aretha Franklin's song, Just Like a Natural Woman. Yeah, but I was really, just like a natural woman. Whoa, long light, long light. Sometime it can backfire. So it's a matter of perspective, you know? People get upset because they have to do things. I have a couple of friends of mine now, the doctor said they have to go to a gym. That's all they do is whine when they go. I said, why don't you look around you when you're in a gym? And there are some funny people at a gym. You get two types of people that go to the gym, the ones that want to be there and the ones that don't. You can tell the difference. I'll never forget the time I was at a gym, there was a guy sitting on a bike and he wasn't pedaling. I said, you have to pedal. He said, no, I'm gliding downhill. I said, you're gonna get a heck of a windburn there, Sparky, I'll tell you. We go through the course of our days, we let other people's attitudes control our attitudes, not realizing we have a choice and how to deal with it. We take it personally. I realize I was in total control of this. I don't let anybody's bad mood put me in a bad mood anymore. It doesn't make any sense. And I realized I was in control of this about a year and a half ago when I was in the Midwest and I needed some stationery. So I went to a Kmart store. And I'm going to tell you something. The woman behind the counter had a major, major attitude. It was so bad that the six people that were in line with me, I heard them talking. The guy in back of me is going, who does she think she is? I'm going to go over there and I'm going to give her a piece of my mind. I'm like, oh, great, that's all we need is somebody with no mind at all, giving somebody a piece of it. And I'm thinking the old me would have put her in her place. I would have told her off, and I would have said, boy, I was a triumphant. I really told her, huh? But what would have been solved? Nothing. You know what the new me did? I took off my shoe, I put it by my ear, and I went, hello, chink? Yes, it's Max. I'm at Kmart, and apparently the girl behind the counter is a spy. How can I tell? She has a bug up her butt. I had everyone in this line in tears, in tears. As a matter of fact, the guy in back of me said, hey, can I use your shoe? I have to call my wife. Everyone walked out in a good mood. It's a matter of perspective, what you want to look at. We get upset because we watch the news and we say the news causes us to get upset and everything, you know. I don't get upset at the news anymore. I just try to see the humor in it. There are things that bother me. Like right now, they're legalizing marijuana for medicinal purposes in California. I'm not here to judge. They say it's good for cancer patients and people with glaucoma. But you know we're going to get carried away with this. I know we are, that we live in that type of society. 2 years from now, somebody will go, oh, yeah, it's good for hemorrhoids, too. Oh, yeah, it's good for headache. You got a headache? It's really good for that. Oh, yeah. You ever walk in the kitchen and hit your foot on the kitchen table? Oh, it's really good for that, too. That's what's going to happen. I don't want to live in a society where anyone thinks that they can light up a marijuana cigarette anytime they want to. I don't want to do that. I fly a lot in a plane. I don't want to be sitting in the plane listening to the pilot and the co-pilot going. Here, man, you drive. Drive, I can't even see. This is your captain. Hey, how you doing? All right, listen, do me a favor. If you're not eating your cookies that were served with lunch, could you pass them up front? I appreciate it. Like I said, I'm not here to judge, but I feel I have a right to say something on this topic because I used to do drugs many years ago, and I'm proud to say I stopped. I don't do it anymore. But I had to stop. I had a very bad experience. I was watching a football game. The team got into a huddle, and I thought they were talking about me. Plus, they say secondhand smoke from cigarettes is bad for people. That's proven. Could you imagine secondhand smoke from a marijuana cigarette in a household? Even the cat's walking around going, ruff. No, I mean meow, meow, meow. I forgot. Put those laughter caps on, folks. That's all, man. Look at the bright side of things. Try and see it from a different perspective. Reconditioning your brain, that's what it is. It's observing and developing your own humor insights. Next time you look at the news, look at it as if it were the Comedy Channel, because sometimes it is. I heard this on the news. 1% of the ozone layer is gone. It's never coming back. Does anybody know what the main reason is for this? Anybody? No, it's cow gas. I kid you not. Did anybody hear this besides me? Because I'm not making it up. Did you hear about it? They did studies, folks. The methane from cow gas, you heard about it. The methane from cow gas is destroying the ozone layer. They weighed it. Now, how do you weigh cow gas? And who's the guy that has this job? What's his title? Hi, I'm a bovine flatulence engineer.
In layman's terms, it means I weigh cow gas. Every morning I stand behind a cow with a big baggie. Sometimes the gas gets in the baggie, sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes the smell gets so bad my garage door opens before I get anywhere near my house. Come on, that's an embarrassing job. You know what? Because you know everybody makes fun of this guy. Even the cows make fun of this guy. Hey, he's right back here. I know, I just ripped one so hard, milk came out of my nose. What's he doing now? He's crying, that's what he's doing. Hey, Elsie, rip another one, see what happens. Man, his eyebrows are gone. What are you doing? Thank you very much, folks. You've been wonderful. I appreciate it. There's a lot more. Thank you.
Well, good evening. How you guys doing? We're doing good. Thank you, Steve. That was wonderful. What a way to get started off here tonight. Sing along if you want to. I could just sit around making music all day long. As long as I'm making music, I know I can do nobody wrong. And who knows, maybe someday I'll come up with a song that makes people want to stop their fussing and fighting just long enough to sing along. Put your hands together. I believe in music. Yeah. Oh, I believe in love. You see, music is love and love is music, if you know what I mean. People who believe in music are the happiest people I've ever seen. So clap your hands, stomp your feet, shake your tambourine. Lift those voices to the sky. God loves it when you sing. I believe in music. Let me hear you now. Oh, I believe in love. Everybody singing, I believe in music. Oh, I believe in love. Music is a universal language, and the love is the key to brotherhood and peace and understanding and living in harmony. So take your brother by the hand and sing along with me. Oh, find out what it really means to be young and rich and free. I think you got this part now, down now, let me hear it. I believe in love. Everybody singing, I believe in music. Oh, I believe in love. Would you help me sing this song, pretty lady? Come on, you were singing so good. How about you? Will you help me? How about you? No takers here. You were singing a while ago. I saw you singing a while. Come out here. I believe in you. Hey, she's good. I believe in you. Give her a hand. Excellent job. How about you? No? How about you? Any girl? No more takers over here. How about you? But come on, help me out just a little bit. I believe in music. Oh, I believe in love. I believe in love. Give my one singer a big stand up and take a bow. Yes, and she's a woman. I love that. I love that. That is great. Thank you for helping me. And you got a good voice. I got a little bit of a cold tonight of all the drugs that you guys have in this room tonight. And I have become a cold, so excuse me for kind of doing this at you, but I needed that help, and I really appreciate that. It is great to get to be with you tonight, and we have looked forward to this time. I've learned a lot tonight. I didn't know I was going to get so educated here with all these graphs and things, and we appreciate what you guys do because we like living a healthy life. So we appreciate the fact that you have some good drugs, legal drugs, to help us with all that, and the doctors and the expertise in this room to make that happen. I do want to clear up a couple of things before we go any further, and I want to thank you, Mark, for pronouncing my name correctly. My first name is LaDonna.
okay? It is not Madonna. Hopefully the differences between us are quite obvious. You see, I wear my underwear on the inside of my clothes, where it belongs. And then my last name is Gatlin, and yes, I'm the baby sister of the Gatlin brothers of country music fame. How many people out there know who the Gatlin brothers are? Ooh, a bunch of you. Well, thank you. Well, you probably didn't know they have a little baby sister, and that would be me. I'm kind of the family's, you know, best kept secret here, but we're trying to remedy that, you know. And it's interesting, as I travel around the country, how the fact that I'm the baby sister gets misprinted in typographical errors and things like that. One time I was in Houston, Texas, and that's my very own native state. Down in Houston, I did an interview for the Houston Post, and they got it wrong. There was a typographical error in there, and rather than saying I was the baby sister of the Gatlin brothers, the typographical error said I was the babysitter of the Gatlin brothers. And another time I was singing at First Baptist Church down in South Texas, Victoria, Texas, and every good Baptist knows that you got to have a church bulletin, you know, on Sunday morning. Well, I had a little church bulletin. They did a little mini write-up about exactly who I was. And rather than saying LaDonna began singing with her brothers at a very early age, in the church bulletin on Sunday morning, it left out that middle G, folks, and it said LaDonna began sinning with her brothers at a very early age. But sing with the Gatlin brothers at a very early age, I did indeed, and we grew up singing in the church. Of course, you know the Gatlin brothers from all their country music hits, and it's interesting. People are always asking my mother, Miss Gatlin, how is it that you have four kids and they all sing professionally? Well, my mom has the best answer. She says, you know, I just don't remember when these kids weren't singing. It seems like from the delivery room, these youngins have been singing. You know, when most babies are born, the doctor holds them up, the babies up by their ankles, and he swats a little bottom, and what do the babies do? They cry, that's right. But if you are a Gatlin, in that delivery room, the doctor holds you up by your little ankles, he swats your bottom, and you go, all the gold in California. You guys probably know that was their biggest hit back in the 80s. And unfortunately, the Gatlin brothers could not be with us here tonight. Because trust me, they would have cost you a whole lot more money than I'm costing you here tonight. But I thought it would be great fun if we could just have our own version of the Gatlin brothers. And I happen to have a piece of paper right here with the names of three gentlemen who have volunteered, who have no idea that they have volunteered, to be the Gatlin brothers tonight. Tim McMullen, where are you, buddy? Are you in the room, Tim? Where's Tim? Tim, come on down. You're going to be the first Gatlin brother with us here tonight. And Stephen Tanzer, where are you, buddy? Stephen? Right here. Give Stephen a big hand. And then Tim Ryan. Where is Tim? Tim, where are you? Over here, buddy. All right. Okay, we got Tim, Stephen, and Tim. So Steve, you're in the middle. Tim, Stephen, and Tim. That makes it easy. Great. Now tell me what you do, Tim.
I'm a family doctor.
Family doctor, so I could probably see you about this afterwards, huh?
Yeah, we could work out a point.
Can we work out a monthly payment plan, too, go along with it? Now, where are you from?
From Youngstown, Ohio, originally.
Youngstown, Ohio. Now, do you know who the Gatlin brothers are? Have you ever heard of Gatlin brothers?
Oh, sure. Big country family.
Oh, good. Great. Okay, this is going to, oh, I can't wait. This is going to work out great. Come on right over here for a second. And then you're Steve, right? And where are you from?
New Jersey.
New Jersey, okay. And you came all the way. Great. We've got some New Jersey people here now. Do you know who the Gatlin brothers are? They have country music up in New Jersey, don't they? So you know who they are?
Correct.
Do you know this song?
Which one?
Oh, All the Gold in California. Okay, great. We'll just put you out here. And Tim, where are you from then?
From Ohio.
Ohio. Ohio? Is that the same state that we're in now?
Yes.
Okay. What part of Ohio? What do you do?
Springfield.
All right, now, these are going to be our Gatlin brothers. Now, guys, I didn't want to leave you high and dry. I did bring you some lyrics, okay, just to be fair. I typed them really big so you can see them, okay? Now, all you have to do, just help them out just a little bit. Everybody in the audience, okay? Just give them a little bit of All the Gold in California, okay? All the gold in California. Okay, now, we just need to hear... You do it all by yourself. Okay. You heard them do it. Now we want to hear your solo version of All the Gold in California. You're on, Betty.
I want to hear Steve first.
No. We're going with the home state boy here first. With this Ohio boy. All right? We want to hear from this Ohio. Okay. All the gold in California. How tight is your underwear, Betty? Murder. mercy. What do you think of this Ohio boy here? They like you. Okay, Mr. New Jersey, you're on. Are you going to pick the same octave he did? All right. All the
golden California.
Don't quit your day job, Steve. Thank you so much. We have some parting gifts for you. Okay, now, Tim, you're on. What do you think? He said, hey, you can do anything and beat these two. All right, let's hear what you got, your best version of All the Gold.
All the gold in California.
He's even got the moves, yeah. Most excellent. Now, that was good, and this is very hard to do, by the way. I mean, I think in statistics that people have been asked, what's the hardest thing in the world that you'd ever have to do? Standing up to speak is probably number one. Standing up to sing has to be a very close second. So that they deserve a huge round of applause. That's very hard to do. You're very good sports. I thank you for that. But everybody knows that a country music artist is only as good as their equipment and their wardrobe. Would you not agree with that? So I brought some other stuff along here just to help us out a little bit. For the big guy in the middle, this New Jersey boy needs a hat, don't you think? Doesn't that add a lot? Yeah. Here you go. And you get the guitar. I had a guy in town that actually tried to tune that thing. And since you are the best singer over here, we're going to give you the rhinestone vest. We spare no expense here. Now, folks, this is what is known as a Kodak moment. If you have your cameras, you're going to want to get a picture of this. So you're going to be so amazed at the transformation that is taking place on all three of these gentlemen. God knows they need the help, right? Now that they have the wardrobe and equipment, you are the Gatlin brothers. Hit it, boys. You're on. Do it. Yeah! Listen to that.
Is it a bank in the middle of Beverly Hills?
What do you think?
Is somebody else's name?
Okay, New Jersey.
So if you're dreaming.
Absolutely no improvement here. Okay, save me here, Ohio. He's a doctor and he can't even read. Give my Gatlin brothers a big hand. Take a bow, gentlemen. Take a bow. Now give me my stuff and get off the stage, please. Thank you. Give them another hand. They were great sports. Thank you, guys. Oh, how funny. Well, besides the Gatlin brothers in my life being a wonderful musical influence, this is a little medley of some of the female artists that I listened to back in the 70s, and I think you'll recognize some of these songs. Everybody can sing along except for those three guys, okay? No, just kidding. Please sing along. Name that tune. Such a feeling's coming over me. There is wonder in most everything I see. Not a cloud in the sky, got the sun in my eye, and I won't be surprised if it's a dream. Everything I want the world to be is now coming true, especially for me. And the reason is clear, it's because you are here. You're the nearest thing to heaven that I've seen. I'm on the top of the world again, down on creation, and the only explanation I can find is the love that I found ever since you've been around. Your love's put me at the top of the world. Who sang that song? Do y'all remember from the 70s? The Carpenters, that's right. And this was their biggest hit. Remember this song? Close to you. Oh, I kissed a lot of boys in high school. Listen to this song. You did too, didn't you? Close to you. I will never forget the Friday. friend Steve Gatlin came up to me and said, LaDonna, I don't have a date tonight. Will you be my date? I want to take you to a movie. Well, that movie was Funny Girl. The lady in it was Barbara Streisand, and the song was People Who Need People.
Just stand by
was fun. I love those songs. You know, I've been singing about my man now for about 23 and a half years, and that's been a great one. Thank you. Believe me, he deserves that round of applause. Tim and I have it all worked out, you see. He doesn't come in my life, and he doesn't come in his life either. And it works out great. We had our 20th wedding anniversary about 3 years ago, and that was a real big event, a big milestone kind of event in that year. And then we had a number of things happen. Our daughter turned 13 that year. Our son turned 16 that year. Tim and I had our 20th wedding anniversary. And I turned 40. Okay? 40. I've been going to therapy, so I can say that. And there's nothing wrong with turning 40, but I happened to turn 40 three short months before my husband turned 40. Tim was loving this. He was sending me some of the most disgusting cards in the mail. Can I just share with you? They were like these little Hallmark moments that you see on television. He was leaving dead roses all around the house. He was loving the fact that I was getting to this 40th birthday before he was. So I poked him one day on his rather expanded 42-inch waistline. How can I say this in a sweet way? Tim had just grown in our marriage. You know, the Bible says your body is the temple of the Lord, right? Well, Tim is a warehouse, okay? I poked him on his 42-inch waistline. I said, sweetheart, you may not be 40 years old yet, but there are some parts of your body that have been in their 40s for some time now. And he said, it's a 42 slim, LaDonna. So he wrote me this little song for my 40th birthday, and I just thought you might like to hear it tonight. It's particularly for all you ladies in the room that you guys can listen to. People say that I'm attractive, that I take away their breath. But when I wake up in the mornings, I scare my husband half to death. Oh, it's hard to look this wonderful, and I'm not ashamed to say, if it weren't for my makeup, I wouldn't be here today. So I'm glad for moisturizer, eyeliner, rouge and base, mascara and concealer, and some lipstick just my shade. Now I can stand up, face the world, and make it through the day. 'Cause there ain't no doubt, I have to say, God bless Mary Kay. I used to use Estee Lauder, Max Factor, Maybelline, but somehow all those other products made my face turn green. CoverGirl just gave me zits and oil of Olay. But I thank you, God, for that Mary Kay cream that took my mustache all away. So I'm glad for moisturizer, eyeliner,